Because I was running the plan, you know, that you were
and
discussing.
I'm sure you're very excited about my candidature.
I'm just wondering, because, I mean, if you're discussing with international agencies, you know, I'm wondering, what is the plan? Because if you ask maybe one who has visited the state once or twice, they'll tell you they have a lot of hotels. So what plan are you, what do you hope to do to change that narrative? Listen, yeah, when you say industrialization, specifically, what exactly?
Job. I am not, Emo State government is not going to say, oh, I'm going to set up a biscuits making industry. But by the time you are governor, I'm already discussing with significant Imo sons and daughters who are into car, I mean, it does in different sectors of the economy. And I know, they give me their word, look, once you come in, and we'll take SSC steps to get there, we'll get there.
So what if you come in and they follow in, as you say, your discussion with them, by the time you finish, you leave, they stop coming back, right?
No, they won't stop coming, because by the grace of God, we leave a legacy. Now, let me give you an instance. When Sam Bakwe was governor, he set up a modern poultry farm that has remained in the history books. Nothing comes into the state coffers from there. We had ceramics industry, nothing comes in. So every other industry in the state is run aground. So we will resuscitate those industries for a start. And we'll create an enabling environment, because I'm not going to say the government is not going to start or are going to have a cashew industry. But we plan to have industrial clusters across the state help assist to make sure that we grow the economy, create job, which is very fundamental.
We'll come back and take a look at this and more before we wrap it up in a moment. Stay with us. All right, welcome back. I'll continue in a moment. Even though I see on the Imo State Board of Internal Revenue website, I had to double check when you talked about the 600 million. Well, they say here that the average monthly IGR moved from about 100 million naira in 1999 to approximately 1.5 billion in 2014. But you're saying that at the moment, it's 600 million.
That's interesting. I'm hearing this for the first time. And I'm sure every other Imo son or daughter will hear this for the first time.
All right, so
that's what I talk about our state.
About the road infrastructure.
Yes.
Because the PDP has ruled the state for a while. And the road infrastructure, they say, well, the government came in and tried to improve upon it. What would you do differently?
I think you talk about decay. The PDP government, interestingly, when I was chief whip of the House of Reps, attracted the construction of dualization of the road from Owerri to Elele leading to River State. That project was awarded at the cost of 23.5 billion. And I'm sure my colleagues in the House then will give me the credit for that effort. And that's the highest amount of project that the federal government has invested in our state. That project was about 60% completed when I left the House of Representatives. I intend that when elected governor, and we will facilitate the completion of that project.
But the PDP was in power, and they didn't complete the Owerri Port Harcourt Road. But now it's getting a lot more
attention. They commenced it. They commenced it, and we lost power, and the job stopped. And we have chairman of APC Governors Forum, who is our state governor. And we have members of National Assembly who are not, of course, in our party.
But the road is being given attention now.
Who is giving it attention?
The Owerri Port Harcourt Road is being constructed, isn't it? The federal government.
I said, we began it. And I said, since I left office, that job has been abandoned. And the records are there. If you check the appropriation bills and the laws signed into law, you have the history. In 2012, 2013, I got the federal government to also award contracts for dualization of the road from Owerri to the airport. I see signs today that the current administration had placed to say it's an IPC administration. That is
okay. Let me just bring this in before we go, because those who question whether you believe in the Charter of Equity and if they can trust you, because they say, as at 1999, that there was that Charter of Equity between Ngopala and Abombisi, and Honorable Greg Egu contested in 1999, and he voluntarily stepped down in 2003.
He went to contest for the Senate.
But they say you took over from 2003, and you didn't step down until 2015. They then wonder, why should they trust you?
No, but I think they trust me, so it's not a case of why should they trust me. I was elected overwhelmingly by the people of Abombisi and Ngopala in the 3 terms I went to the House, and they were willing to support me for the 4th term. because I was bringing dividends, and because I initiated constituency briefing in the state. When I was elected in 2003, in June 2003, when I was sworn in, by December 2003, I had my first constituency briefing, and it became an annual ritual, which we consistently did. So about trust, people trust me. Now, because my performances were very positive, I was encouraged and supported by my party and the people of my constituency to proceed. So I gave benefits of electability to my people. I put a bomb the same and got well into the national political grid.
Well,
and
got
a position of privilege, a position of height as presiding officer in the National Assembly. Which is coming to play positively for us.
We need to anchor at that point, right, Honorable Emeka Ihedioha, the governorship candidate of the PDP. Thank you for coming on.
Thank you very much. I appreciate
it. All right, so there you go. That's the show today. We thank you all for watching. We'll see you tomorrow. I'm Chamberlain Oso.
I'm Neil Tai. We enjoy the rest of your day.
The views and opinions expressed by guests on this program are those of the maker and do not necessarily reflect the views, opinions, and endorsement of Channels Television.